Steve Winwood is more than just one of music's top singers and songwriters. He's a producer, recording engineer, multi-instrumentalist, and three-time Grammy Award winner. The fact that he's still on top of the charts and still making great music is just part of what sets Steve Winwood apart.
I'm not quite sure what sets me apart, but I think it's always important to keep your sights on what first made you successful, and I think that's an important thing, and I think it's easy to lose sight of that, what first made you successful, which was a desire to communicate music and to make it as good as it possibly can be, without any compromise.
Steve Winwood joined the Spencer Davis Group when he was only 15 years old. Spencer discovered Steve's musical talents after seeing him perform in his brother Muff's jazz band. After the show, Spencer recruited them both, and the group was born. By 16, Winwood was already a star. People were astounded by his piano and guitar playing, and no one could believe that such a soulful voice was coming from that skinny little white kid from Birmingham, England.
To me was the band really started out. We used to just really copy blues songs and blues tunes and just try and copy Sonny Boy Williamson or Johnny Hooker or Muddy Waters and just extract licks and copy them, you know, note for note. And then I think what happened is, in the end, the Spencer Davis Group formed its own sound.
Winwood left the Spencer Davis Group in 1967 and formed Traffic with Chris Wood and Jim Capaldi. Traffic's eclectic blend of jazz, blues, and folk music made its debut later that year when they released their first album, Mr. Fantasy.
You know, we used to try and like to encompass a broad spectrum of music. You know, not to get pigeonholed into, you know, folk rock band, or although I suppose that's the closest thing to what it was, is folk rock band. some of that, the traffic stuff, I think, probably get prouder as time goes on, because in some ways it kind of improves for me.
In 1969, at the height of Traffic's success, Winwood took a leave of absence from the band and joined up with Cream's Eric Clapton and Ginger Baker to form one of rock's first supergroups, the short-lived but now classic Blind Faith.
I first met Steve when he was with Spencer Davis, and he was up north in England. He was in Birmingham, and I was down south in London. And the words, the grapevine sort of worked back and forth. You know, people would come down from Birmingham and say, oh man, there's this kid up there that sings like Ray Charles and he's 15 years old, you know. So he was a legend in London, even before I ever saw him. And then when I did see him and he was singing Georgia on My Mind, I couldn't believe it. I mean, this, sorry, Steve, spotty little white kid singing just exactly like Ray Charles.
Nobody loves you.
Eric Clapton and I had worked together, and we wanted to we'd always decided we wanted to work in a band, and his band was winding up at the time, and we decided that'd be a good time. But then I think it got taken out of our hands a little bit and became a marketing business venture.
You are the reason I've been waiting so long. Somebody holds a key.
After the breakup of Blind Faith in 1970, Winwood regrouped with Traffic and recorded John Barleycorn Must Die, originally intended as his first solo album. 4 years and four albums later, Traffic came to an end in 1974.
We tried to do things that were completely innovative and that no one else had done, and that we tried to do things just because no one else had done, which is probably not the right attitude.
In 1977, Winwood finally released his first solo album, simply called Steve Winwood, which is currently out of print. Although it received some critical acclaim, it passed relatively unnoticed in the U.S. After its release, Winwood seriously considered quitting the music business, but changed his mind, and later released a second solo effort, Ark of a Diver.
Ark of a Diver, effortlessly.
That's really why I went into making Ark of a Diver, because, you know, the mid-70s were an odd period musically. There was a lot of, like, backlashes happening, kind of anti-music bands and all kinds of things going on. And so I thought, well, I don't really have anything to lose. I'll just go and get my head down and make this album.
Ark of a Diver turned out to be one of the biggest albums of 1980, a solo album in the truest form. It was written, produced, engineered, and performed entirely by Winwood himself. And the single, While You See a Chance, went all the way to number three.
I thought, after I'd done Aqua Dive, I thought, right, well, I know how to do it now, it's easy. So I just go in and knock out, you know, I made all mistakes on Aqua Dive, so I'll just go in and I'll know how to do it.
In 1982, Winwood released his second album, Talking Back to the Night, another entirely solo effort. The album gave him a minor hit, Valerie, which became a bigger hit in 1987 when he released a remixed version of it on his Chronicles album.
Performance is the same. I just put a bit of guitar on and a few little things on, but changed the sounds of the drums and did some more drum overdubs and changed the sounds, you know, and it really seemed to help a lot.
'86's Back in the High Life was Winwood's first studio album in 4 years, and it put him back on the charts higher than ever. The album won him 3 Grammys, and the first single, Higher Love, went all the way to number one.
High Love is something that you spend years looking for, and you sometimes find it. I have. And you don't waste a
minute of time. After the release of Back in the High Life, Winwood went on tour for the first time in 12 years. It was such a success that the following year, he did it again. After the release of his 5th solo album, this year's Roll With It.
Oh, this album is very much more happier, you know, album. I think gone is that melancholic, you know, side of it, and it's very much for me. It's you know, I'm a slightly different man. I'm much happier than I've been for a long time in my personal life. You can't really, you know, rely on what you've done or on a track record, but, you know, I try and write, produce an album that is valid for now. Obviously, it is important, and it's important not to lose sight of, you know, your own identity and my own identity. There's no point coming out trying to be somebody else, you know, and that's really not what I'm trying to do, but I'm certainly trying to do an album that is, well, you know, just the fact that I'm doing it today, I'm just hoping that it is valid today.